We're also supporting an investigator, Gordon Broderick, at the University of Alberta, who's working with the team at the University of Chicago and the University of Miami to look at cytokine and gene expression markers in the blood of adolescents who have recovered from infectious mononucleosis caused by Epstein-Barr virus and those who have not recovered from EBV, from mono. And what he, this is some kind of hot off the press results that show panels of cytokines and sets of gene expression markers are able to differentiate kids who have recovered from infectious mononucleosis versus those who stay sick. And these are kids who are still sick 24 months after mono. So we're now working on looking exactly what these markers are and combinations of markers are. And these, as you can imagine, would be potentially predictive markers for in a pediatric population where the rates of infectious mononucleosis are very high. So if you could intervene a lot earlier, you may prevent people from staying sick. How many of you know about the microbiome? A few people know about the microbiome. We're supporting one other study that is looking at the microbiome. The microbiome is one of the newest and hottest phenomena, I think. It was in the cover of Nature. It's thought of as our other genome. We have microbes that live inside us and on us. There are 10 times more microbes in human, more microbes in us than there are our own human cells. We have 3 million genes, 150 times more the human genome complement or the human gene complement. So these genes have to be doing something, have to be adding somehow to our overall health and well-being. And now it's becoming clear that that is in fact the case. The study that we're supporting is looking at the microbiome, or what's going on in the gut in people with CFS. This team is led by Sanjay Shukla at Marshfield Medical Research Foundation in Marshfield, Wisconsin. They too are using an exercise study, and they're working with an exercise physiologist at the University of Wisconsin-Madison to study what happens when a person goes through an exercise. Again, this exercise paradigm is really trying to capture why there is this post-exertion malaise in CFS that is the hallmark of CFS. So after subjects are exercised, stool samples are taken before and after exercise in conjunction with blood samples taken before and after exercise. And these investigators are copying the LIGHTS protocol and that they're taking samples at the same time period so that ultimately we can cross-compare the results between the teams. And they're looking specifically to see whether or not exercise causes bacteria in the gut to translocate, to jump across. Does it weaken the gut epithelium so that the bacteria actually cross at higher rates and cause an inflammatory response in the individuals? They're also looking to see whether or not there's altered ratios of good bugs to bad bugs in the gut. Is there something that's ongoing to cause this imbalance in people with CFS? And maybe that's what's causing the epithelium to be leakier in people with CFS, et cetera. So this study will be important to get at these aspects of the microbiome as one explanation for a sustained pro-inflammatory response in CFS, as well as this post-exertion phenomena. There's been a list of infectious agents associated with CFS over the past 20 years. This is just a short list of them. EBV, Q fever, which is a coxiella, which is a rickettsial agent, HHV6, parvoviruses, West Nile viruses, enteroviruses, chikungunya virus, which is now spreading across the U.S. as West Nile virus did the past or a few years back. Recently, last year in 2009, this virus, XMRV, or xenotropic murine-related leukemia virus, was found in patients with CFS. And just last month, a polytropic murine leukemia virus was found in patients with CFS. So there's been a lot of infectious activity in CFS. We don't know yet whether any of these are etiologic and or biomarkers. They could be one or the other, or in fact, they could be both. So the jury's still out on many of these. I wanted to just give you an update on XMRV. Dr. Singh will be talking about XMRV at great length in the next lecture. I was just at the, and so is Dr. Singh, the first international XMRV workshop, which was held at NIH Tuesday and Wednesday. It covered kind of the basics on XMRV retrovirology and also a little bit on some of the polytropic MLVs. They covered what has been found in both CFS and in prostate cancer over this day and a half. I have a couple of take-home messages from the meeting. First of all, and if you guys aren't aware of this, we can discuss this later on, there are several discrepant studies in both CFS and prostate cancer. In other words, some investigators have found it and others have not. These discrepant studies could be due to the methods that the investigators are using, the samples that the investigators are taking, and the populations that the investigators are studying. So none of this has been fleshed out yet. But we know that it's there and sometimes and it's not in others. And these are some of the explanations for these discrepancies. We also know now that polytropic MLVs are common. And polytropic MLVs this was the type of virus that was found in the PNAS paper that was published last month. These viruses are very common and are widespread among house mice and lab mice, so they're somewhat ubiquitous, and in fact, many other mammalian species. So this is a very common, not surprisingly, set of viruses that are very widespread. So far, these polytropic MLVs have not been shown to be infectious because people that have detected them have only detected the genetic material. We have not seen a virus particle in tissues or have not been able to culture the cells in order to show an infectious MLV particle. Only XMRV has been cultured and has been shown to be able to infect blood cells. Antiretroviral therapy was a hot topic of discussion at this meeting, and it is not recommended. Many of you may know that some people are already using antiretroviral therapy because of these very preliminary studies. And I think the harm at this point likely outweighs the benefit. However, this has really inspired investigators to move very quickly with methods development and optimizing methods, so that the prevalence of these various agents can be determined in the population, so that these populations that have the specific viruses can then be targeted for clinical trials. At that time, the consensus was that clinical trials would be warranted, and that's clinical trials of antiretrovirals. Even though there's still a lot of uncertainty, a lot of controversy in this field, there is a tremendous amount of excitement that has been generated for CFS research at NIH, in the blood banking communities, at pharma, CDC, FDA, and in the academic world. CFS is really now on the radar because of XMRV. And again, these are some of the studies that are currently underway. How common is XMRV in CFS? What about antiretroviral therapy? Is XMRV transmitted in the blood? There are studies now looking at blood donation and transfusion practices, look-back studies to see people that have donated blood or people who have received blood. Are there increased rates of CFS? And there's also a number of animal models that are under development. And these are the models. I'm going to end up now saying that because of all this information, this is the kind of model that we have been able to develop for CFS. This is more of a picture, a snapshot of how we understand what is going on in CFS. But as you can see, it gives us a number of opportunities to target specific areas and tweak them or treat them or develop tools for objective means of diagnosis. I just want to put in a little bit of a plug for our biobank, which is now a resource that we're providing to the scientific community so that scientists interested in studying CFS and these infectious agents will have a standardized set of tools and as far as questionnaires and other types of instruments to assess CFS, and samples from well-characterized populations to be able to study CFS and identify markers for diagnosis and treatment. And Dr. Bateman is a supporter and also a contributor to this biobank. Okay, question. The Solve CFS Biobank is a resource for biomarker discovery and validation research that provides private clinicians and patients the opportunity to participate in CFS research. Would you be likely to provide CFS Biobank information to your patient population? And there's brochures out on the table outside, in addition to a bunch of toolkits that were produced by CDC and the CFIDS Association for you to take home today. Okay. Yes, I like that. Not ready for prime time. Okay, come and talk to me at lunchtime. What is needed to bring biomarkers discussed here into clinical care? Okay, and these are five, so it's 1 through 5. Better laboratory technology, replication and validation of biomarkers. Biomarkers are not needed. CFS is too heterogeneous, or you don't know. And we'll go. Good answer. Thank you very much.